Turn with me to 1 Corinthians chapter 12. We have been in this chapter the entire series so far. We're going to look at part A of verse number 10. 1 Corinthians chapter 12, just the first part of verse number 10. Amen. It says, to another the working of miracles, to another prophecy. Let us pray. Lord, we thank you for all that you do as always. We thank you for your grace and your mercy. Lord, as I stand here today and proclaim your truth and proclaim your word, please decrease all of me and increase all of you. Holy Spirit, as always, have your way. It is in Jesus' name that we do pray. Amen. You may be seated in the presence of the Lord. We're still in the What Is My Gift series, and today we're going to talk about prophecy on today. Okay, this is part six of What Is My Gift, and we're going to talk about prophecy on today. Like I said, take notes, pay close attention, okay? Go back after me and study yourself. Everything I teach, always go back and study yourself. Study to show thyself approved. Amen. So let's talk about prophecy on today. The office of a prophet, many believed, ceased when the New Testament canon was complete. In other words, when the entire Bible was complete and done and sealed. Many theologians, many scholars believe that the office of a prophet ceased. All right? They believe that the primary gift of prophecy in the early church was to lay the foundation of the church. And you have to remember this, is that during that day, many of them did not have the entire Bible in their hands. Okay? So, therefore, God used men and women of God to lay the foundation that the church could build on that foundation. All right. Now, does God still use certain people to speak to certain people his will? Absolutely. Absolutely. It's just that when it comes to new revelation, there is no new revelation concerning the Bible. Okay? We discussed this the other week when we talked about the word of knowledge. When it comes to fresh, new revelation, there is no new revelation. The Bible is complete. The Bible is sufficient. And if any man comes and says something that is not in the word or contradicts the word, you need to dismiss them. If they say they have a word from the Lord and they try to prophesy something that does not line up with the word, you need to throw it out like yesterday's trash. There is no new revelation when it comes to the word. That ship is sailed. The Bible is sealed. The foundation has been set, and Jesus Christ is the chief cornerstone of that foundation. So there is no new revelation, but God will still sometimes use certain individuals to prophesy and speak his truth, because he is sovereign. He can do anything that he wants to do. The song just say he has all power. So he can still do that if he wished to do that. Now, some people, they used prophecy just like they use a psychic. Some people use prophecy just like they use a psychic. As we discussed the other week, we are to stay away from psychics and fortune tellers and all of that stuff. That stuff is demonic. So although the gift of prophecy was used as a way to build the early church, it still does not mean that God would not use particular people when he wants to use them to prophesy his divine will. All right? I remember a few years ago, I was in the room with this individual when this individual began to prophesy different things. And I'm in the room listening to this person prophesy different things. I know the whole backdrop. I know everything that's happening. And this person began to prophesy what God was going to do. And since I knew the whole story, I'm like, whoo, that's, if God does that, he's still in the miracle working business. So I'm in the room, this person's prophesying, 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 and you can feel the Holy Spirit in that room. And although I have the gift of faith, a part of the elder couple was like, I don't know. But you can still feel the presence of the Lord in that room. And you can sense that that person was on a different level. It was almost like they were out of themselves as they was prophesying and prophesying and prophesying. And I knew the whole situation, Sam. And I'm like, man, if that comes to pass, it would be a miracle. Sure enough, a few months later passed by. Everything that person prophesied in that room on that evening came to pass. My mind was blown. Because I thought I knew God. And I thought I really had the gift of faith. But although I was still a little bit kind of, I don't know. But it came to pass. So God can still use people to prophesy. Right? God can still use people to do that. Now, what is prophecy? What exactly is prophecy? Prophecy is defined as this. It's defined as a temporary ability to bring a word, warning, exhortation, or revelation from God under the impulse of the Holy Spirit. I'll read that again. Prophecy is defined as a temporary ability to bring a word, warning, exhortation, or revelation from God under the impulse of the Holy Spirit. All right? Prophecy simply means to speak forth. Right? To speak forth, to declare God's divine will. But watch this. Now check this out. With grace, right?
Yes, sir.
Prophecy, you will speak forth God's divine will. Check this out. Good or bad. Yeah. Well, let's talk about that. I know it's happening all around, all the good stuff. All the good stuff. All, give you all the good stuff. Prophecy, they can prophesy something good or bad. Because sometimes people, that's all they want to hear is the good stuff. But prophecy can be a warning for you to turn from your wicked ways. Prophecy can be a way that God is saying, I love you so much that I'm going to warn you of what you need to do. I don't know if my mother was a prophet or not, but she warned me a whole lot. Yeah, she gave a whole lot of warnings. I knew he thought I was a perfect child. I knew you'd be a bush of buck. But she warned me a whole lot. But prophecy is when you speak forth and you declare things, whether it's good or whether it's bad. Let's look at something that's in your Bible that I did not write there last night. Turn with me to Isaiah, that major prophet, Isaiah chapter 30. Isaiah chapter 30. We're going to have Bible study on a Sunday morning. Isaiah chapter 30. We're going to look at verses 1 through 11. And I'm going to read this in the Living Bible translation because it kind of breaks it down a little bit easier. And I really want you to feel the impact of this. And this is in your Bibles now. Isaiah chapter 30, verses 1 through 11. Remember, I said the good stuff or the bad stuff. Isaiah was a prophet. Okay? He was a major prophet. He was the eagle-eyed prophet. All right. So, Isaiah 30, verses 1 through 11. I'm reading from the Living Bible translation here. It says, whoa. That's the first word. Whoa. Whenever God starts out with whoa, you need to be like, whoa. Whoa. To my, watch this, rebellious children, says who? The Lord. You ask advice from everyone but me and decide to do what I don't want you to do. You yoke yourselves with unbelievers, thus piling up your sins. For without consulting me, you have gone down to Egypt to find aid, and have put your trust in Pharaoh and his protection. But in trusting Pharaoh, you will be disappointed, humiliated, and disgraced. For he can't deliver on his promises to save you. For though his power extends to Zoan and Hanes, yet it will all turn out to your shame. He won't help one little bit. See them moving slowly across the terrible desert to Egypt, donkeys and camels laden down with treasure to pay for Egypt's aid. On through the Balans that they go, where lions and swift venomous snakes live, and Egypt would give you nothing in return. For Egypt's promises are worthless. The reluctant dragon, I call her. Now go and write down this word of mine concerning Egypt so that it will stand until the end of time, forever and ever, as an indictment of Israel's unbelief. For if you don't write it, they will claim, I never warned them. Oh no, they'll say, you never told us that. For they are stubborn rebels. They tell my prophets, shut up. Let me read that again. That sounded real good. They tell my prophets, shut up. We don't want any more of your reports. Or they say, don't tell us the truth. Watch this now. It's in your Bibles now. Don't tell us the truth. Tell us nice things. Tell us lies. Forget all this gloom. We've heard more than enough about your Holy One of Israel and all he says. That is in your Bibles. There are some people that would not heed unto prophecy if it's not what they want to hear. They'll say, don't tell us that. We don't want to hear the bad stuff. Tell us the good stuff. Tell us how much money I'm going to make. Tell us the big house I'm going to move into. Tell us the boot I'm going to marry. Tell me the good stuff. Don't tell me anything bad. But tell me the good stuff. And they close their ears to what God is trying to tell them. They'll say, don't tell us what God is telling you to tell us. That's just one example. I just found one example. There's plenty more in the Bible. You go back to study. But that's what people do. And a lot of times in biblical days, prophets were despised in those days. They didn't want to hear what thus saith the Lord. He was warning them and they didn't want to hear it. They said, if I'm headed down the wrong path, don't tell me that I'm headed down the wrong path. Well, Greg said, I don't know about you, but if I'm headed down the wrong path, I want God to at least send me a warning. To let you know I need to turn from my wicked ways, turn from the direction in which I'm going. If I fell off the tracks, Lord, give me a warning so I can be placed back on the right tracks. And sometimes God will use prophecy to do that. Now, let's look at this. Let's learn some more things. I'm telling you to learn something. They would tell you need these doors. Verse number 10, if you have the King James Version or maybe another translation besides the Living Bible translation, verse number 10, it has a word that it says seers. S-E-E-R-S. You see that in your Bible? You have the King James? Okay. Let's go to seminary. Seers. Okay. Let's look at verse number 10. I'm going to read this in the King James. It says, which say to the seers, see not, and to the prophets, prophesy not unto us right things, speak unto us smooth things, prophesy deceit. The word seer is used 21 times in the Bible, and all 21 times is used in the Old Testament. Okay? Now, the question is, what is a seer? Why do you bring this up, Pastor? Why do need to know what a seer is. A seer was another name for a prophet. A seer was another name for a prophet. Watch this. But also, watch this. These prophets would see things in visions and dreams. And God would speak to them in visions and dreams. Hence the name seer. All right. So you can write these down. We don't have time to kind of look them up, but just write these scriptures down. And I kind of read quickly. But a few of these examples are 1 Samuel chapter 9, verse 19. 1 Samuel chapter 9, verse 19. It says, "And Samuel answered Saul and said, I am the seer. Go up before me into the high place, for ye shall eat with me today and tomorrow. I will let thee go, and will tell thee all that is in thine heart." Another example is 1 Chronicles 21 and verse 9. 1 Chronicles 21 and 9 says, "And the Lord spake unto Gad, David's seer." Okay? Last one for right now. Amos chapter 7, verse 12. Amos 7, verse 12. It says, "And Amaziah said unto Amos, O thou seer, go flee thee away into the land of Judah, and there eat bread, and prophesy there." All right. So these individuals that I just mentioned, they're prophets, but they're also seers. All right. God will speak to them through visions and dreams and so forth. God will speak to them in vivid ways. Let's look at another example. Let's see this in demonstration of how God spoke to a seer, which is also called a prophet. Now let's turn to Jeremiah chapter 1. So if you have a Bible study on Sunday morning, it's good to say amen.
Amen.
Jeremiah chapter 1. Let's look at verses 11 through 13. We're going to look at this. You're going to see this in action here. Jeremiah chapter 1, verses 11 through 13. It says, "Moreover, the word of the Lord came unto me, saying, Jeremiah, what seest thou?" Check it out. "And I said, I see a rod of an almond tree. Then said the Lord unto me, thou hast well seen. For I will hasten my word to perform it. And the word of the Lord came to me the second time, saying, what seest thou? And I said, I see a soothing pot, a seething pot, and the face thereof is toward the north." See, something key takes place here in the text. Notice that God does not ask Jeremiah what he thinks or what he feels. He said, "Jeremiah, what do you see?" God was speaking to Jeremiah through this vivid vision. Okay? He was speaking to him, asking him, "What do you see in this vision?" That was another way that God spoke to his prophets and to his seers in biblical times. So in the Old Testament, prophets played a major role in being the mouthpiece of God. As a matter of fact, the Bible even mentioned there were at least three schools of prophets in the Bible. The students of those schools, probably students of either Samuel, Elijah, or Elijah. One of those three, those three schools of prophets that they had in the Bible. Either they were students of Samuel, Elijah, or Elisha in the Bible. And these prophets were sharp. It wasn't just a title with them, because a lot of people just like titles. They just give me a title, then I'll go to work. But these prophets, these seers, they weren't doing this just for a title. It wasn't just about titles, man. They weren't putting on a show. They weren't doing things just to draw large crowds. These were real prophets, and when they spoke, things came to pass. Their words, El Coleman, did not fall to the ground when they prophesied. If they spoke something, it came to pass, and that was the true test of a prophet. On the other hand, if you have true prophets, that means you also have, watch this, you have false prophets. Because if you have true prophets, you got false prophets. You have these counterfeit prophets. You have these fake prophets. You have these parking lot prophets. You have these phony baloney prophets. And they don't prophesy, they do what? They prophet lie. Yeah, you didn't say that before. They don't prophesy, they prophet lie. They say things and it does not come to pass. And the Bible is full of instructions on how we should treat these false prophets. It says to stay away from them. It says to beware of these false prophets. Why? Because they don't care anything about you. They're hirelings. They have been hired to do what they're doing. They are self-seeking and they're only out for, watch this, themselves. Now, I'm almost done with my little message here. Watch this. Something that is not mentioned a lot about prophecy is this. A lot of times when a preacher is teaching the word of God, when they're teaching the truth, okay, that's another form of prophecy. Let me break down. Pay close attention this morning. When a preacher, when they're up here preaching the truth, not lies, the truth, the word of God, that's another form of prophecy. They're called a prophesier. Okay? Alright. Let's get a little bit deep. We're gonna go deep, then we'll come up for air in a second. You can write this down and go back and study on devoted study time. You have general revelation, and then you have special revelation. General revelation or special revelation. Let me break it out. General revelation is this. Have you ever heard the question posed to you as far as people may say, well, how does someone in a far country, if they were to die, go to heaven if they never knew about Jesus? Y'all hear that question posed a lot?
Yeah.
Okay. General revelation is this. Romans 1:20 talks about this. It says that if you look at nature, all right, if you look at the beauty of what God created, you have to know that it was something behind the beauty of it. Sun in the sky, moon in the sky, stars, clouds, mountains, seas, oceans. Somebody has got to be behind that. Romans 1:20 talks about this in your Bibles.
Yes, sir.
That's general revelation. In other words, it is God revealing himself to man through nature.
Amen.
That's what general revelation is. God revealing himself to man through nature. So if somebody asks you the question, how does someone make it to heaven in a far country in the bush of Africa where they had never heard of Jesus Christ? Because you have to what? Confess with your mouth and believe in your heart that God raised Jesus from the dead, you will be saved, right? That's what Romans 9:10 saying and so forth, right? So watch this. God in his justification and in his fairness and how just he is that he will use general revelation to bring salvation to those individuals, watch this, if they have never heard of Jesus. Old Testament. Jesus wasn't on the scene in the Old Testament, okay? Although there were different times he came pre-incarnate at different times when you read the Old Testament, but since people believed in God, they were still saved. Because in the Old Testament, they did not confess Jesus Christ as Lord and Savior because Jesus Christ was not on the earth in the Old Testament. But since they believed in God, God accounted that to them for righteousness and they are saved. And we'll see them one day in heaven. We'll see Abraham in heaven. We'll see Moses in heaven. We'll see them in heaven. We might even see that crazy Jonah in heaven. I'm like, Jonah, what are you doing, Brandon? So anyway, we'll see them in heaven. All right? So general revelation, although they have, if you're in a different far country, I'm going somewhere with this, stay with me. If they're in a different country or somewhere where they have not heard about Jesus, If they die, okay, they can look at nature and say, you know what? Somebody created this. This is beautiful right here. Whoever created this, I believe in that person. They can be saved.
That's
general revelation. When you get home, study it for yourself.
Yes, sir.
All right, that's general revelation. Now, y'all like, where's he going? Is he talking about prophecy? What are you talking about, Pastor? Okay, special revelation, the other one. What is special revelation? Special revelation is the word of God or Jesus Christ himself. All right, that's special revelation. The word of God, or the ultimate special revelation, which is Jesus Christ himself. All right, so the special revelation, since special revelation is the word of God, when a preacher, okay, is standing up teaching the word, okay, watch this. When I said earlier that with prophecy in the early church, they laid the foundation that the church built upon that foundation, which the ultimate foundation, the chief cornerstone is who? Jesus Christ, special revelation. So when the man of God is up here preaching and teaching the word from what the things that the apostles have done, what the prophets have done, and then we now have the entire Bible in our hands, all 66 books of the Bible, 39 of the Old Testament, 27 of the New Testament, all 66 books from Genesis 1 to Revelation 22, when the man of God is standing up here teaching and preaching the word, what he's doing, he's talking from special revelation and prophecy, since it was laid down as special revelation in the Bible. As he teaches, prophecy goes forth, because a lot of times you can be in your seats and the preacher have not been to your house, but it seems like he has opened up your mailbox, and the things you have prayed about, the things you have asked God about, the things you have asked God to reveal to you, sometimes you're sitting in your seats and you're squirming and you're squirming and you're squirming. Why? Because God is using the man of God or the woman of God to teach them his word, and prophecy is hitting you because the Holy Spirit is speaking to you through special revelation. Teach, Pastor, I'm trying the best I can. That's special revelation. Study those out when you get home. That'd be some good, good, good study. Just write a little essay on yourself just so you can really dig deep into it. I promise you will learn something from that. That's special revelation. But also, as I mentioned, the greatest special revelation is Jesus Christ. But not only that, watch this. The greatest prophet of all time was also Jesus. Jesus was God in the flesh, but he also fulfilled the role and the title of a prophet. As a matter of fact, Jesus even referred to himself as a prophet in Mark chapter 6, verse number 4. Mark 6, verse number 4, says this. It says, but Jesus said unto them, watch this, a prophet is not without honor, but in his own country and among his own kin and in his own house. Watch this. Jesus foretold of things to come, and it came to pass. Jesus performed miracles, and miracles were done that could not be explained because Jesus was also a prophet. Look, Jesus checked out all of the check boxes for the title of prophet. Okay? And I know other religions, they try to keep him just as a prophet and not as him being divine. They don't talk about his deity. They say, oh, he was just a prophet. No, he was more than just a prophet. He was also God in the flesh. But he did fulfill the role and the title of a prophet as well. So in closing, there is no new revelation when it comes to the word of God. No new revelation. If someone comes and says, you know, the Lord told me that this and this is going to happen, and this is what you need to do, and this is what you need to obey and be obedient to it, and it does not line up with the Word of God, there's no new revelation. Because a lot of times people will say, God has given me this fresh revelation, and it's something completely different than what you've been studying yourself, than what you've been learning yourself. Now, how can that possibly be when the Word of God says this? You know, I love to get door knocks on my door. I love my doorbell to ring some Saturday. I love it. Late time said, I love that. I live for that. Sometimes I see them walking, I'm like, please come over here. I love to have a conversation with you. Because when you put them in a corner, they start to stutter. Uh-huh. And they start to backtrack. They say, oh, he was just a prophet. He was just this and that. But my Bible says, no, no, well, that's your Bible. But what my Bible says is this right here. You have to know your Bible. You have to know your Word. And when it comes to prophecy, although the title or the office of a prophet, many believe ceased when the New Testament canon, when it was canonized, meaning that, let's talk about this Holy Spirit. When the whole Bible was canonized, they called it canonized, the whole canon, okay? It was the Council of Nicaea, when they all got together and they ratified the Bible. Okay, they weren't really saying if it was true or not. They're just saying, okay, we'll take this and place it in the Bible because a lot of churches are teaching on this. Churches ain't teaching on this garbage right here. Go to the other side right there. So that's how the whole Bible came to be. Okay, this Council of Nicaea came together and they looked at the different churches, okay, and they compared everything together with what the churches were teaching, and since everything fell in line with what was said about Jesus, what was said about God, they compiled everything together and the Bible was canonized. It's the canon, C-A-N-O-N. Studied that too. Y'all learning some stuff. Y'all been to seminary, y'all just don't even know this one. But when the whole Bible was canonized, many theologians, many scholars, many of them, the majority of them, believe that the office of a prophet ceased. Do I believe that? I believe that too. But it's not to say, watch this, it is not to say that God will not use people to prophesy. God is sovereign. He can do whatever he wants to do. God, like I gave that story earlier, when I was in that room and that person was prophesying, I'm like, there is no way this is going to come to pass. That's why I say within myself. A few months later, that everything came to pass. Everything came to pass. And I was blown away from that. So God will use people to prophesy, but they have to be under the impulse of the Holy Spirit. They can't just say things just to say things. Because sometimes I'll say this to y'all been in church for a while. Somebody be talking to somebody on it in the back and like, go ahead, prophesy. Are they under the Holy Spirit to do that? You have to be under the Holy Spirit to prophesy. And some people God will use to do just that. Prophesying is speaking forth. It's declaring the truth. It's declaring God's divine will. Okay? And sometimes, watch this, sometimes it's not always good stuff. Sometimes it is warnings to warn individuals of what they need to stop doing, where they need to go. We read in Isaiah chapter 30, when God warned the people. What did they say? We don't want to hear that. Tell us the good stuff. Don't tell us the truth. It's in your Bibles. And there's many more examples of that in the Word of God. But God can still use men and women of God under the direction of the Holy Spirit to prophesy and to speak forth. He can still do it. Some of you probably have experienced that before. I know God has used me to do that here at the Grace Center. Okay? But you have to be careful of those individuals when they say things, and then your discernment kick off. You'd be like, no, that's not in the Bible. That doesn't line up. My spirit is a little bit troubled right now. Your spirit is troubled because they could have been a false prophet and not a real true prophet. Amen.